Beautiful song. Beauty for Ashes. Praise to the Most High God, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and peace to everyone that's here today. Peace to everyone that's watching us live online as well as listening in on the phone line. And as always, it's good to stand before you on the Lord's Sabbath day. And like we always do, we open this book and we read it and we get some understanding. And today we're going to deal with a lesson called A Peculiar People. And a peculiar people, that means strange. Somebody that stands out. But when it came to the nation of Israel, we were supposed to be peculiar in a righteous way. People were supposed to be coming to us to learn how to serve the true and living God. And we're going to show you, we did have that capacity for a hot minute, and then we went back door. And now people are mimicking us for the wrong reasons. Amen. But the Lord is going to flip that. When he comes back, he's going to flip it. It's going to be, we're going to be the people that he chose us to be. And if he have to beat us down to do it, which he's going to do, he's going to beat us into submission, and we're going to act right. But until then, we are the poster child for sin. Whenever somebody comes out the closet, Israel. Man. Whenever somebody beating up on their wife, Israel. Crime, Israel. They always quick to show Israel's face when it comes to any kind of crime being committed. Man. But anybody else, you know, you always know who did the crime because they show your face. But let's get to the lesson. Let's call it Peculiar People. Peculiar People. Exodus 19. We're going to start this in Exodus 19. Pick it up at verse 4. Exodus 19 and 4. Okay, read.
Ye have seen what I did unto the Egyptians, and how I bare you on eagle's wings, and brought you unto myself. Now, therefore, if ye will obey my voice indeed and keep my covenant, then ye shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people, for all the earth is mine.
So if you obey my voice and keep my covenant, then you shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people, for all the earth is mine. The whole earth belongs to the Lord. All the nationalities belong to the Lord.
That's right.
But it's only one set of people that's supposed to stand out. And those are his people. Go ahead.
6. And ye shall be unto me a kingdom of priests and an holy nation. These are the words which thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel. And Moses came and called for the elders of the people and laid before their faces all these words which the Lord commanded him. And all the people answered together and said, all that the Lord hath spoken we will do. And Moses returned the words of the people unto the Lord. And the Lord said unto Moses, lo, I come unto thee in a thick cloud, that the people may hear. And when I speak with thee and believe thee, I will speak with thee and believe thee forever. And Moses told the words of the people unto the Lord.
So the Lord told Moses what to tell the people. And like always, Israel is all about lip service. They said, okay, we're going to do everything the Lord said. We're going to do it. Keep reading.
And the Lord said unto Moses, go unto the people and sanctify them today and tomorrow, and let them wash their clothes and be ready against the third day. For the third day, the Lord will come down in the sight of all the people upon Mount Sinai.
So he said, okay, I heard what they said. Now I'm going to come down and talk to them and see if they really want to do exactly what I say. But let's look at this word peculiar, because we like to make sure you understand exactly what's going on here. So we're going to look at the definition of peculiar. I couldn't print this up, but y'all got a dictionary. Everybody got one of them fancy phones. Look it up. Peculiar, what does it mean? Go ahead.
Not usual or normal.
Not usual or normal. That means you are not the normalest type of person or the normalest group of people. What else?
Characteristic of only one person, group, or thing. Distinctive.
Characteristics of only one person, group, or thing. You are distinctive. That's what peculiar means. What else?
different from the usual or normal.
Different from the usual or normal. You stand out like a sore thumb. You stand out because you are doing things that are what? Out of the norm. If the world is full of wickedness and that's normal and you ain't doing the wickedness, that means you standing out.
True.
If everybody within their conversation, every other word is MF this and whatever, and you don't say no kind of curse words, they look at you, something wrong, you know, they notice.
Yes, real.
You are peculiar. There's something distinctive about you. And with Israel, it was supposed to be on the righteous level. And we're going to show you that. Let's go to Acts chapter 7. So the Lord came down on Mount Sinai and spoke all these words. He gave them the commandments, 10 commandments, and a whole bunch of other stuff that they were supposed to do. Acts 7. Because if you're going to choose the people, you're going to show them exactly how to serve you. There's always rules and regulations when it comes to a nation of people. Everybody has it. 7 and 38, read it.
This is he that was in the church in the wilderness with the angel which spake to him in the Mount Sinai and with our fathers who received the lively oracles to give unto us.
So everybody know what oracles is. Oracles are answers.
Yes, sir.
We are supposed to be the answer nation for the rest of the world. People are supposed to flock to us to find out how to serve the one true living God. Because if you're serving the one true living God, we're going to show you who's going to get blessings beyond your capacity. Let's go to Romans chapter 3. Flip right over to Romans 3. So the Lord gave us the answers. And we still got them.
Yep.
We got them. People don't want to believe it. But we got the answers. Anytime something's going wrong, you can read in the book. Whenever Nebuchadnezzar had a dream, his partners couldn't answer for him. He had to go to the who? The answer people, Israel. He wouldn't got Daniel. Same thing with Pharaoh. When he had a dream, his partners couldn't interpret it. Had to go to Israel. We got the answers. You just don't know it. Romans 3, verse 1, read it.
What advantage then hath the Jew? Or what profit is there of circumcision?
What advantage? Everything. Go ahead, verse 2.
Much every way, chiefly, because that unto them were committed the oracles of God.
That's why, that's the advantage that we have. We got the answers. You can go to school all your life. You still won't be able to. If you don't have no understanding, teach somebody about the word of God.
Preach, man.
I don't care how many theological schools you go to.
Preach.
The oracles was given to Israel. You want to learn how to serve God? Come on, we'll tell you. Because we open this book and we read it. It's all written down.
It is.
It's written in the book, but people just don't want to read it. It's too hard. They throw the law out the window. They say you can't keep that law. If you can't keep a law, then it's a free-for-all. You do what you want to do. You serve God your way, I serve him my way, and we're all kumbaya to heaven together. I beg to differ. Deuteronomy chapter 4.
Kumbaya.
Deuteronomy 4, and pick it up at verse 1. Deuteronomy 4 and verse 1. Okay, read.
Now therefore, hearken, O Israel, unto the statutes and unto the judgments which I teach you, for to do them that ye may live and go in and possess the land which the Lord God of your fathers giveth you.
Now we all know what hearken means, right? Hearken means to listen.
Yes.
Listen to what I'm telling you, Israel. Listen. Go ahead.
Ye shall not add unto the word which I command you, neither shall you diminish aught from it, that you may keep the commandments of the Lord your God, which I command you.
So don't add nothing to what I tell you, and don't take nothing away from it. Do it to the letter, and you will live a long, happy life. Mm-hmm. Skip down to verse 5 and read it.
Behold, I have taught you statutes and judgments, even as the Lord my God commanded me, that ye should do so in the land whether you go to possess it.
So whatever land you in, you're supposed to keep these laws. Even though he scattered us, we still have to keep these laws. Go ahead.
Keep therefore and do them, for this is your wisdom and your understanding in the sight of the nations which shall hear all these statutes and say, surely this is a great nation, is a wise and understanding people.
So these commandments, you keep them and you do them. Why? Because this is your wisdom in the sight of all the nations. You're going to stand out.
Right.
If you're keeping the law. I guarantee you're going to stand out. First and foremost, you're going to stand out with your family. Because they're going to think you're crazy. But you're crazy in a good way.
Right.
Because you're keeping the law. Because that's your wisdom in the sight of all nations. And somebody going to say, wow, surely this nation is wise and understanding people. What else? Verse 7.
For what nation is there so great who hath God so nigh unto them as the Lord our God is in all things that we may call upon him for? And what nation is there so great that hath statutes and judgments so righteous as all this law which I set before you this day?
And what nation is so great and righteous that has all these judgments and all this law? Just imagine if the whole world was keeping the law. I mean, everybody keeping the law. And they're going to end up doing it anyway.
Eventually.
But just imagine to this day. It's like I say, the Sabbath starts Friday evening. Just imagine, just in L.A. alone,
right,
if Israel would just keep the Sabbath.
Make it plain.
Wouldn't be no crime. Police would be like, wait a minute, what's going on? They'd be trying to ride around to see what's happening. But everybody be shut down in their house or somewhere getting some understanding. And if Israel is doing their job, maybe the police can take a day off. Because it wouldn't be no crime. But it all starts with the Sabbath day. But people want to throw that out the window. They want to give you 20 minutes on Sunday. Or not even that. You ain't got to go. Just watch it on TV. And then turn to the football game. But the Sabbath is 24 hours. We finished that?
Verse 9.
Verse 9, read it.
Only take heed to thyself. And keep thy soul diligently, lest thou forget these things which thine ears have seen, and lest they depart from thy heart all the days of thy life. But teach them thy sons and thy sons' sons.
So he's giving you a warning. Take heed. Do not get big-headed because I'm on your side.
Right.
And I'm blessing you. Don't get big-headed. Because once you get big-headed, you're going to forget who gave you all these blessings.
Yep.
So he's warning you. Take heed. And in the process of doing that, teach it to your kids. Teach it to your sons and their sons all the days of their life. You have to. You just can't keep this to yourself. You got to teach it to your children.
Yes.
Let's go to Psalm 147. Psalm 147. This is what makes you stand out, keeping these laws. A peculiar people, strange people. Why y'all want to do right all the time? Because it's right. Well, you can do a little, you know, it ain't nothing wrong. You know, you can sin a little bit. Ain't nothing wrong with it, no.
No.
You got to do right.
Period.
Psalm 147, verse 11, read it.
The Lord taketh pleasure in them that fear him, and those that hope in his mercy.
So the Lord takes pleasure in who?
Those that fear him.
Because if you don't fear the Lord, I guarantee he ain't taking no pleasure in you. Go ahead.
Praise the Lord, O Jerusalem. Praise thy God, O Zion. For he hath strengthened the bars of thy gates. He hath blessed thy children within thee. He maketh peace in thy borders and filleth thee with the finest of wheat. He sendeth forth his commandment upon the earth. His word runneth very swiftly. He giveth snow like wool. He scattereth the hoarfrost like ashes. He casteth forth his ice like morsels. Who could stand before his cold? He sendeth out his word and melteth them. He causeth his wind to blow and the waters flow.
Now this is the God we serve. What else do we do? Go ahead.
He showeth his word unto Jacob, his statutes and his judgments unto Israel. He hath not dealt so with any nation, And as for his judgments, they have not known them.
So he only gave his statutes and his judgments to Israel.
That's what we read.
We're the only ones that got it. And because we rejected it, the Lord is punishing us. People were supposed to come to us for righteousness. But like I said, now we're being mimicked for the wrong reasons. But we are still God's people. Let's go to Joshua 4 and let's look at some of this power that he gave his people, these peculiar people. Let's look at what Joshua did. Joshua 4, and we're going to pick it up at verse 19. Joshua 4 and verse 19. Okay, read.
And the people came up out of Jordan on the 10th day of the first month and encamped in Gilgal in the east border of Jericho. And those 12 stones which they took out of the Jordan did Joshua pitch in Gilgal. And he spake unto the children of Israel, saying, when your children shall ask their fathers in time to come, saying, what mean these stones? Then ye shall let your children know, saying, Israel came over this Jordan on dry land. For the Lord your God dried up the waters of the Jordan from before you until you were passed over, as the Lord your God did to the Red Sea, which he dried up from before us until we were gone over, that all the people of the earth might know the hand of the Lord that is mighty, that you might fear the Lord your God forever.
So the Lord did that for his people. He split the Red Sea. He dried up the Jordan River so they could walk into the land. He did that for his people. Why? So all the earth should know that these are my people and I'm their God. And if they do what I say, you ain't seen nothing yet.
That's right, brother.
Let's go to Joshua 10. Let's show you what Joshua did. Now, this is strange right here. All these other nations, Sennacherib, all the big talking he did about all the gods he destroyed, he ain't never did this.
Huh.
Joshua 10, pick it up at verse 6. Now, Israel's in battle. Okay, go ahead.
And the men of Gibeon sent unto Joshua to the camp to Gilgal, saying, slack not thy hand from thy servants. Come up to us quickly and save us and help us. For all the kings of the Amorites that dwell in the mountains have gathered together against us.
So now the Amorites is coming against the Gibeonites, okay? So they came to Joshua and said, we need some help, man. Remember, you made a league with us. You got to protect us. So what did he do? Go ahead.
So Joshua ascended from Gilgal, he and all the people of war with him, and all the mighty men of valor. And the Lord said unto Joshua, fear them not, for I have delivered them into thine hand. There shall not a man of them stand before thee.
So the Lord told Joshua, look, don't even worry about these dudes. I got this. I got this. Don't even worry about it, because you're doing what I'm telling you to do. I got it. Go ahead.
Joshua therefore came unto them suddenly and went up from Gilgal all night. And the Lord discomfited them before Israel and slew them with a great slaughter at Gibeon and chased them all along the way that goeth up to Beth Horon and smote them to Azekah and unto Makkedah.
So who smote them? Who killed them? The Lord did. So much for God not killing nobody.
Huh.
This is what the books say. The Lord slew them. Go ahead.
And it came to pass, as they fled from before Israel and were in the going down at Beth Horon, that the Lord cast down great stones from heaven upon them unto Azekah. And they died. They were more which died with hailstones than they whom the children of Israel slew with the sword.
So the Lord killed more with the hail.
Huh.
Than he did with Israel when Israel was killing them with the sword. So you see who was doing all the fighting. Israel was just there, swinging their sword here and there. But when the Lord started raining them hailstones, it was over. It's a wrap. Go ahead. Verse 12.
Then spake Joshua to the Lord in the day when the Lord delivered up the Amorites before the children of Israel. And he said, in the sight of Israel, sun, stand thou still upon Gibeon, and thou, moon, in the valley of Ajalon. And the sun stood still, and the moon stayed until the people had avenged themselves upon their enemies.
So the Lord said, look, Joshua said, Lord, we need some more daylight to keep killing these people. Don't let it get dark on us. So the sun stood still. Anybody that can do this, they got to be peculiar. Strange to make the sun stand still and the moon don't you come up either. Sun don't go down, moon don't come up till we finish killing all these people. This is the God that we serve. Go ahead.
Is not this written in the book of Jasher? So the sun stood still in the midst of heaven and hasted not to go down about a whole day. And there was no day like that before it or after it that the Lord hearkened unto the voice of a man. For the Lord fought for Israel.
So this is your daylight saving time right here. It's right here where the sun didn't go down. But let's go to 2 Samuel chapter 7. And let's look at David. 2 Samuel 7. So if we continue to keep the commandments, we'll be a peculiar people above all nations. Yes, can't nobody do this. Can't nobody make the sun stand still. Only God's people can do this. Because we read, nothing ever happened like this before. Not with anybody. What'd I say? 2 Samuel?
2 Samuel 7.
Okay, start at verse 1. Read it.
And it came to pass, when the king sat in his house, and the Lord had given him rest round about from all his enemies, that the king said unto Nathan the prophet, see now, I dwell in the house of cedar, but the ark of God dwelleth within curtains.
So now here's David. He's sitting in his house, and he got rest from all his enemies. That means David had knocked off everybody. A shepherd, a dude that was tending sheep, turned out to be what? The greatest warrior that Israel ever had. A shepherd boy. Playing the drums. He ain't played no drums. That's just something else. But anyway. So he became the greatest warrior we ever had, knocked off all the enemies. But go ahead, keep reading.
Verse 3. And Nathan said to the king, go, do all that is in thine heart, for the Lord is with thee. And it came to pass that night that the word of the Lord came unto Nathan, saying, go and tell my servant David, thus saith the Lord, shall thou build me a house for me to dwell in? Whereas I have not dwelt in any house since the time that I brought up the children of Israel out of Egypt, even to this day, but have walked in a tent and in a tabernacle. In all the places wherein I have walked with the children of Israel, spake I a word of any of the tribes of Israel, whom I commanded to feed my people Israel, saying, why build ye not me a house of cedar? Now therefore, so shalt thou say unto my servant David, thus saith the Lord of hosts, I took thee from the sheepcote, from following the sheep to be ruler over my people, over Israel.
Go ahead.
And I was with thee whithersoever thou wentest, and have cut off all thine enemies out of thy sight, and have made thee a great name, like unto the name of the great men that are in the earth.
And why did he do this to David? Because David followed his commandments. He took him, he turned him from a shepherd and to the greatest warrior to be the ruler over Israel. Go ahead.
10. Moreover, I will appoint a place for my people Israel, and will plant them, that they may dwell in a place of their own and move no more, neither shall the children of wickedness afflict them any more as before time. And as since the time that I commanded judges to be over my people Israel, and have caused thee to rest from all thine enemies, also the Lord telleth thee that he will make thee an house. And when thy days are fulfilled, and thou shalt sleep with thy fathers, I will set up thy seed after thee, which shall proceed out of thy bowels, and I will establish his kingdom. And he shall build an house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever.
And we know that's Jesus, but that's another lesson. Skip down to verse 22 and read it.
Wherefore, thou art great, O Lord God, for there is none like thee, neither is there any God beside thee, according to all that we have heard with our ears. And what one nation in the earth is like thy people, even like Israel, whom God went to redeem for a people to himself, and to make him a name, and to do for you great things and terrible for thy land before thy people, which thou redeemest from thee, from Egypt.
And what one nation in the earth is like thy people? Ain't no nation like us, brothers and sisters.
Huh.
We gonna be the best or we gonna be the worst, either one. Right now we the worst. On all levels. This can only be coming from God. Because when you good, when we was at the fullest of our full potential, we was at the top. And everybody knew about Israel. But now, we on the bottom. Everybody know about you too. Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
From the nations and their gods. 24. For thou hast confirmed to thyself thy people Israel to be a people unto thee forever. And thou, Lord, art become their God. And now, O Lord God, the word which thou hast spoken concerning thy servant and concerning his house, establish it forever, and do as thou hast said. And let thy name be magnified forever, saying, the Lord of hosts is God over Israel, and let the house of thy servant David be established before thee.
So how do we magnify the Lord God of Israel? By keeping his laws, his statutes, and his commandments. You stand out. That's the God that you said they want to know. Why are you doing all this, and why all these blessings coming upon you? I serve the God of Israel. You want some of these blessings too? This is what you got to do. Go ahead.
For thou, O Lord of hosts, God of Israel, has revealed to thy servant, saying, I will build thee an house. Therefore, have thy servant found in his heart to pray this prayer unto thee. And now, O Lord God, thou art that God, and thy words be true. And thou hast promised this goodness unto thy servant. Therefore, now let it please thee to bless the house of thy servant, that it may continue forever before thee. For thou, O Lord God, hast spoken it. And with thy blessing, let the house of thy servant be blessed forever.
Okay, let's flip over to 23. That was some good reading. I like that. 2 Samuel 23. And let's look at some of David's homies. Some of the stuff that they did that nobody can compare to. 2 Samuel 23, and pick it up at verse 8.
Okay, read.
These be the names of the mighty men whom David had. The Tachonite that sat in the seat, chief among the captains, the same was Adino, the Enzanite. He lift up his spear against 800, whom he slew at one time.
This cat killed 800 people at one time, with a spear, 800. And he didn't have no Uzi or none of that. He had a spear. Can't nobody lay claim to that. No other nation can lay claim to that, only in Israel. This cat killed 800 people. Go ahead.
And after him was Eleazar, the son of Dodo, the Elhanite, one of the three mighty men with David, when they defiled the Philistines that were gathered together to battle, and the men of Israel were gone away. He arose and smote the Philistines until his hand was weary, and his hand clave unto the sword, and the Lord wrought a great victory that day, and the people returned after him only to spoil.
So this cat killed so many people till his hand got tired, and he couldn't even drop that sword. It was like part of his hand. But he killed so many people. This was a mighty man. This cat was an Israelite. Skip down to verse 18 and read it.
And Abishai, the brother of Joab, the son of Zeruiah, was chief among them. And he lifted up his spear against 300 and slew them, and had the name among three.
So he killed 300. This is
crazy.
One person killing 300 people and not getting a scratch. Go ahead.
Was he not most honorable of three? Therefore, he was their captain. Howbeit, he attained not unto the first three. And Benaiah, the son of Jehoiada, the son of a valiant man of Kabzeel, who had done many acts, he slew two lion-like men of Moab.
Now, I don't know what a lion-like man is, but they had to be pretty strong. Go ahead.
He went down also and slew a lion in the midst of a pit in the time of snow.
So not only did he kill two lion-like men, he killed a lion too.
In a pit.
In a pit with snow.
Woo.
Go ahead.
And he slew an Egyptian, a goodly man. And the Egyptian had a spear in his hand, But he went down to him with a staff and plucked the spear out of the Egyptian's hand and slew him with his own spear.
So he went down with a staff. This Egyptian got a spear. He went down with a stick, took the spear out of his hand and killed him with it. Go ahead.
These things did Benaiah, the son of Jehoiada, and had the name among three mighty men.
So these were the mighty acts that some of David's men did because they were serving the God of Israel. And that's pretty peculiar. If you're going to kill a lion, you're a strange dude to me.
Man, word.
I do not want to mess with you. As a matter of fact, I want some of that strength too. What do I need to do so I can go kill a lion?
If need be.
1 Kings chapter 4.
Word.
1 Kings 4. So we see all the mighty acts that David did, but David was doing this to set it up for Solomon, to make sure everything was in order for his son so he wouldn't have to lift a finger to nobody. All he'd have to do was sit on that throne and dispatch wisdom. Go ahead. 1 Kings chapter 4, verse 29. Read it.
And God gave Solomon wisdom and understanding exceeding much, and largeness of heart, even as the sand that is on the seashore.
So that's a whole lot of wisdom. The sand on the sea, that's a lot. You can't even count that. That's how much wisdom Solomon had. And can't no other ruler lay claim to this. Israel had the wisest king that ever lived. His wisdom surpassed all these. Who do they give us now? Plato and
Socrates
and
Descartes,
Freud and all these other clowns. They don't compare to Solomon. Go ahead.
And Solomon's wisdom excelled the wisdom of all the children of the East country and all the wisdom of Egypt.
So all those brothers who want to go into Egyptology, Israel had the wisest man. Because his wisdom exceeded all the wisdom, not some of all the wisdom of Egypt. Go ahead.
For he was wiser than all men, than Ethan, the Azahite, and Heman, and Chalcol, and Darda, the sons of Mahol, and his fame was in all nations round about.
I guess these cats were the Socrates and the Platos of their time. But Solomon's wisdom exceeded all of them, and his fame was in what? All the nations. Because that is your wisdom among all the nations. That is your understanding in the sight of all the nations, keeping the law. Go ahead.
32. And he spake 3,000 proverbs, and his songs were 1,005.
So he spake 3,000 proverbs, and he wrote 1,005 songs, and all of them was number one hits. Number one on the charts, all of them. Go ahead.
And he spake of trees, from the cedar tree that is in Lebanon, even into the hyssop that springeth out of the wall. He spake also of beasts and of fowl and of creeping things and of fishes. And there came of all people to hear the wisdom of Solomon, from all kings of the earth which had heard of his wisdom.
And this is Israel, a peculiar people. This is what we're supposed to have. Let's go to 1 Peter 2. This is what makes us stand out. This is what makes us funny, peculiar. We have the answers of God. 1 Peter chapter 2. We're going to read a couple of verses. 1 Peter 2. Start at verse 9. Go ahead.
But ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, and holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness unto his marvelous light, which in times past were not a people, but are now the people of God, which had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy.
But we are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people that should do what? Show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness and into this marvelous light. We are funny people. We funny ha-ha right now. People are laughing at us. Shaking their head at us. And there's a reason for that. Go to Leviticus 26. Leviticus 26. you can see God's people, when they get into anything, Israel excels above everybody. In sports, they try to keep us out of sports. Why? Because they know once we got in, we was going to take over. I'm still waiting on us to get to that swimming thing. But just let us get in there. Just let us get in there. We're going to take it over. Because we excel. We are God's people. Leviticus 26, verse 2, read it.
You shall keep my Sabbaths and reverence my sanctuary. I am the Lord. If you walk in my statutes and keep my commandments and to do them.
So if you walk in my statutes, keep my commandments and do them, because remember, that's your understanding in the sight of all nations. That's your wisdom. Look what the Lord is going to do to you. Verse 4.
Then I will give you rain in due season, and the land shall yield her increase, and the trees of the field shall yield their fruit. And your threshing shall reach into the vintage, and the vintage shall reach into the sowing time. And ye shall eat your bread to the full and dwell in your land safely.
You won't have no problems. You're going to be rich in abundance. Won't be lacking in anything. Go ahead.
And I will give peace in the land, and ye shall lie down, and none shall make you afraid, and I will rid evil beasts out of the land, neither shall the sword go through your land.
You're going to have, you can go to sleep and not have to worry about locking your front door or putting bars on your windows. Or worrying about if I happen to leave the garage door up all night. Won't nothing happen. Go ahead.
And ye shall chase your enemies, and they shall fall before you by the sword. And five of you shall chase 100, and 100 of you shall put 10,000 to flight. And your enemies shall fall before you by the sword. For I will have respect unto you and make you fruitful and multiply you and establish my covenant with you. And ye shall eat old store and bring forth the old because of the new. And I will set my tabernacle among you, and my soul shall not abhor you. And I will walk among you and will be your God, and ye shall be my people.
Only if you keep the commandments.
Right.
We read that number right at the top. Right. Only if you keep the law. Because if you ain't keeping the law, you ain't getting none of this. We finished that?
Yes, sir.
Okay, go to Deuteronomy 28. We're going to read it again. Deuteronomy 28. I would like to hit the lottery every time I played it. To the point they wouldn't even have it no more.
Israel, huh?
Yeah, that's us, man.
That's us. Him again?
Deuteronomy 28, verse 1, read it.
And it shall come to pass, if thou shalt hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe and to do all his commandments, which I command thee this day, that the Lord thy God will set thee on high above all nations of the earth.
So you listen diligently and you do what the Lord says, he will set you on high above all the nations. You're going to be top dog above all the nations. Go ahead.
And all these blessings shall come on thee and overtake thee, if thou shalt hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God. Blessed shalt thou be in the city, and blessed shalt thou be in the field. Blessed shall be the fruit of thy body, and the fruit of thy ground, and the fruit of thy cattle, the increase of thy kind, and the flocks of thy sheep.
So you're going to be blessed, blessed, blessed. If you keep the commandments. There's no such thing as being blessed and highly favored, and you going to church on Sunday.
Preach, brother. Make it plain.
What do the books say?
Sabbath day.
Keep the commandments, you get blessed. You can't be blessed and highly favored if you're going to church on Sunday. That's an oxymoron. Is that what it is? It can't happen. You're getting blessed, but it ain't coming from God. I guarantee you that.
Preach.
Because what does Satan tell Jesus? He showed him all the kingdoms of the earth and the riches.
Make it plain.
And he said, look, I will give you this because what? It is mine to give to whomever will bow down to me.
That's what he said.
When you chase that money, all that glory and all that fame, Satan. That's who you bowing down to. That is who you serving. Because you ain't serving God. We finished that?
Yes, sir.
Deuteronomy 7.
Keep the commandments.
Deuteronomy 7. Every time the Lord tell you I'm going to bless you, you always say if.
If.
There's nothing free when it comes to the Lord.
Preach, brother.
You have to work and do things to get paid. Deuteronomy 7, verse 6, read it.
For thou art an holy people unto the Lord thy God. The Lord thy God hath chosen thee to be a special people unto himself, above all people that are upon the face of the earth.
Go ahead.
The Lord did not set his love upon you, nor choose you because you were more in number than any people, for ye were the fewest of all people.
So we were the fewest of all people. We weren't the majority. We was the minority among all people, but the Lord chose us to be a peculiar people unto him. He took the people that was the fewest and raised them up to the people that was the highest, to the most. Go ahead.
But because the Lord loved you, and because he would keep the oath which he had sworn unto your fathers, had the Lord brought you out with a mighty hand and redeemed you out of the house of bondmen from the hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt.
So you know who we can thank? Abraham.
Man.
Because the Lord made a promise to him if he did what the Lord told him to do, and he did it.
Thank the Lord.
And now the Lord has got to keep his promise to him. Thank Abraham, because if it wasn't for Abraham, I guarantee you we would be wiped off this planet. So the Lord, he keeps his covenants. We the deal breakers. So we got to get punished for it. But because he made that promise, thank Abraham. Because we're going to get back into the land. But go ahead, keep reading.
9. Know therefore that the Lord thy God, he is God, the faithful God, which keepeth covenant and mercy with them that love him and keep his commandments to 1,000 generations, and repayeth them that hate him to their face to destroy them. He will not be slack to him that hateth him. He will repay him to his face. Thou shalt therefore keep the commandments and statutes and judgments which I command thee this day to do them.
Go ahead.
Wherefore, it shall come to pass, if ye hearken to these judgments and keep and do them, that the Lord thy God shall keep unto thee the covenant and the mercy which he sware unto thy fathers.
So you got to keep the commandments. There's that if again. Go ahead.
He will love thee and bless thee and multiply thee. He will also bless the fruit of thy womb and the fruit of thy land, thy corn, thy wine, and thine oil, the increase of thy kind and thy flocks of thy sheep in the land which he sware unto thy fathers to give thee. Thou shalt be blessed above all people.
Thou shalt be blessed above all people if you keep his commandments. We're going to stand out above all people. We will be that 5% that's out there that got everything. 1%. That's what Israel is, 1%.
1%.
We will be that 1%. And everybody going to be coming to look for us to see where we're getting all these blessings from. Go ahead.
There shall not be a male or female barren among you or among your cattle.
Everybody going to be having kids. All the women. Won't none of them be barren. You're going to be dropping out babies every year and loving it. Right now, don't nobody want to have no babies. You're going to be having babies and loving it. Won't nobody be barren. Go ahead.
And the Lord will take away from thee all sicknesses and will put none of the evil diseases of Egypt which thou knowest upon thee, but will lay them upon all them that hate thee.
And we won't have no diseases.
Wow.
But right now we got them. We number one in everything. Go ahead.
And thou shalt consume all the people which the Lord thy God shall deliver thee. Thine eye shall have no pity upon them, neither shalt thou serve their gods. For that will be a snare unto thee. If thou shalt say in thine heart, these nations are more than I, how can I dispose them? Thou shalt not be afraid of them, but shall well remember what the Lord thy God did unto Pharaoh and all unto all Egypt.
So don't be looking across the fence. The grass is not greener on the other side, contrary to popular belief. The grass is greener right where you at. Exactly. Put some water on it.
Put some water on it.
Fertilize it.
That's right.
It is green right there. Keep reading.
19. The great temptations which thine eyes saw, and the signs and the wonders, and the mighty hand and the stretched out arm, whereby the Lord thy God brought thee out, so shall the Lord thy God do unto all people of whom thou art afraid. Moreover, The Lord thy God will send the hornet among them until they that are left and hide themselves from thee be destroyed. Thou shalt not be affrighted at them, for the Lord thy God is among you, a mighty God and terrible. And the Lord thy God will put out those nations before thee by little and little. Thou mayest not consume them at once, lest the beasts of the field increase upon thee. But the Lord thy God shall deliver them unto thee, and shall destroy them with a mighty destruction until they be destroyed.
So you ain't going to get rid of everybody at once. He let you have a little fun while you're doing some killing. Don't kill them all at once. Just do it a little bit at a time. That's if you're doing what you're supposed to do. That's how peculiar you're going to be. You're going to win every battle. Undefeated. Go ahead.
24. And he shall deliver their kings into thine hand, and shall destroy their name from under heaven. There shall no man be able to stand before thee until thou hast destroyed them. The graven images of their gods shall ye burn with fire. Thou shalt not desire the silver or gold that is on them, nor take it unto thee, lest thou be snared therein. For it is an abomination to the Lord thy God. Neither shalt thou bring an abomination into thine house, lest thou be cursed, be a cursed thing like it, but thou shalt utterly detest it, and thou shalt utterly abhor it, for it is a cursed thing.
And that's where Israel went down. They got caught up in idolatry. We had it good for a long time. But then we started looking across the fence. And then we started serving them other gods. And we read in the script that the Lord is a jealous God. He don't play. So if you're not keeping his commandments, then you got the curses coming to you. Let's go to Ezekiel 16. Ezekiel 16. So you're going to be peculiar in a good way, or you're going to be in a bad way. Either way, you still my people, and you're going to stand out. Ezekiel 16, verse 1. Read it.
Again, the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, cause Jerusalem to know her abominations, and say, Thus saith the Lord God unto Jerusalem, Thy birth and thy nativity is the land of Canaan. Thy father was an Amorite, and thy mother a Hittite. And as for thy nativity, in the day that thou was born, thy navel was not cut, neither was thou washed in water to supple thee. Thou was not salted at all, nor swaddled at all.
So now the Lord is giving you the rundown on how he found Israel. There was nothing when he found them. There was nobody. Go ahead.
None I pity thee to do thee any of these things, to do any of these things unto thee, to have compassion upon thee. But thou was cast out in the open field to a loathing of thy person in the day that thou was born.
Go ahead.
And when I passed by thee and saw thee polluted in thine own blood, I said unto thee, When thou was in thy blood, live ye. I said unto thee, When thou was in thy blood, live. I have caused thee to multiply as the bud of the field, and thou hast increased and waxen great. And thou art come to an excellent ornaments. Thy breasts are fashioned. Thine hair is grown, whereas thou was naked and bare. Now, when I passed by thee and looked upon thee, behold, thy time was the time of love. And I spread my skirt over thee, and covered thy nakedness. Yea, I swear unto thee, and entered into a covenant with thee, saith the Lord God, and thou becamest mine.
And we read that in Deuteronomy 7. We were the fewest in number. He didn't choose us because we were the majority. We were the fewest in numbers, and nobody liked us. So he set his love upon us, washed us up, gave us some fine clothes, mighty men, wise kings, great generals, great warriors, great everything. We had it. Go ahead.
9. Then washed I thee with water, yea, I thoroughly washed away thy blood from thee, and I anointed thee with oil. I clothed thee also with broidered work, and shod thee with badger skins, and I girded thee about with fine linen, and I covered thee with silk. I decked thee also with ornaments, and I put bracelets upon thine hands and a chain on thy neck. And I put a jewel on thy forehead and earrings in thine ears, and a beautiful crown was upon thy head. Thus was thou decked with gold and silver, and thy raiment was of fine linen and silk embroidered work. And thou didst eat fine flour and honey and oil, and thou was exceedingly beautiful. And thou didst prosper into a kingdom.
So that's why Israel was likened to a fine woman. Any brother that got a fine woman, you're going to parade them in front of everybody. Let you know, this is what I got. Look at it. Don't touch it. But look what I got.
Preach.
That's what he did with Israel.
Right.
He took them from nothing, brought them up to the highest level where all the nations was coming to him because of the wisdom.
Right.
But what happened? Keep reading.
And thou renown went forth among the heathen for thy beauty, for it was perfect through my comeliness, which I had put upon thee, saith the Lord God.
So Israel was perfect. Why? Because of the Lord.
Right.
And what happens? When you get caught up in your big-headedness, go ahead, verse 15.
But thou didst trust in thine own beauty and playedst the harlot because of thy renown and pouredst out thy fornication on everyone that passed by. His it was.
So you got big-headed. You started looking on the other side where the grass you thought was greener. And you forsook the Lord and started playing the harlot. Go to
skip to 22
and read it. Go ahead.
And in all thine abominations and thy whoredoms, thou hast not remembered the days of thy youth when thou was naked and bare and was polluted in thy blood.
So you forgot where you came from.
Right.
The Lord took you from nothing, brought you up to something. Now all of a sudden you forgot where you came from. Go ahead.
And it came to pass after all thy wickedness, woe, woe unto thee, saith the Lord God, that thou hast also built unto thee an eminent place and hast made thee a high place in every street.
So it came to pass after all that other wickedness, when the Lord say, whoa, it ain't nothing nice.
Mm.
After all that wickedness, now you're going to set up a false god. Go ahead.
Thou hast built thy high place at every head of the way and hast made thy beauty to be abhorred. And has opened thy feet to everyone that passed by and multiplied thy whoredoms. Thou hast also committed fornication with the Egyptians, thy neighbors, greater flesh, and has increased thy whoredoms to provoke me to anger.
Started worshiping everything. Israel is caught up in every religion that's on this planet. And if they got something new coming out, give them a while. They'll be up in it too. Go ahead.
27. Behold, therefore, I have stretched out my hand over thee and have diminished thine ordinary food and delivered thee unto the will of them that hate thee, the daughters of the Philistines, which are ashamed of thy lewd way. Thou hast played the whore also with the Assyrians because thou was unsatiable. Yea, thou hast played the harlot with them and yet couldst not be satisfied. Thou hast moreover multiplied thy fornication in the land of Canaan unto Chaldea, and yet thou was not satisfied herewith.
And when we say fornication, it is spiritual fornication. Now, this is idol worship.
Yes.
Worshiping these other gods.
Yes.
Go ahead.
How weak is thine heart, saith the Lord God, seeing thou doest all these things, the work of an imperious, whorish woman, and that thou buildest high thine eminent place in the head of every way, and makest thy high place in every street, and has not been as an harlot in that thou scornest higher.
So we did so much idolatry, the Lord is comparing it to a harlot. You giving harlots a bad name.
Because
at least they get paid. You just giving it away. Go ahead.
But as a wife that committeth adultery, which taketh strangers instead of her husband, they give gifts to all whores, but thou givest thy gifts to all thy lovers and hirest them, that they may come unto thee on every side for thy whoredom. And the contrary is in thee from other women, in thy whoredoms, whereas none followeth thee to commit whoredoms, and in that thou givest a reward, and no reward is given unto thee. Therefore, thou art contrary.
So you giving harlots a bad name, Israel. You had the one true living God, and you gave him up for some idol worship, and you go wholeheartedly at it. You serve them false gods. We used to serve them. We was all in it at one time.
Yes, we were.
at Sunday school on time.
Yep.
Sunday school started at 8. Parents made sure you got there. They stayed home. They made sure you went. And there was so much discipline, too. But what happened with Israel when they find out the truth? All discipline goes out the window.
Preach.
You don't want to do nothing.
Rebuke.
Don't want to be told to do nothing. And it's coming right out the book. We get lax. We have more discipline in Sunday worship than we do up in here.
Admonish.
And it shouldn't be like that. We are serving the true and living God. It should be order in here.
Rebuke.
And in all the other camps too.
Admonish.
Because remember, we came from the hotel. And we got a spot. You saw what they did to us the first hotel. Then we got another one. They was about to tighten the screws on us on that too. Till it was a point they was going to kick us out. But now we got this place and now you can kick back, right? Kick your feet up and don't do nothing.
Admonish.
We need to maintain order up in here. We serving the true and living God. This is not the only thing. I guess you should carry some of that sun worship discipline up in here.
Rebuke.
Leave all that other mess behind, but bring the discipline with you. We finished. Keep reading.
35. Wherefore, O harlot, hear the word of the Lord.
So wherefore, harlot, hear the word of the Lord. You want to go ahead and do all that idolatry? I'm going to tell you what I'm going to do to you. 36. Go ahead.
Thus saith the Lord God, because thy filthiness was poured out, and thy nakedness discovered through thy whoredoms with thy lovers, and with all the idols of thine abominations, and by the blood of thy children which thou didst give unto them. Behold, therefore I will gather all thy lovers with whom thou hast taken pleasure, and all them that thou hast loved, with all them that thou hast hated, I will even gather them round about against thee, and will discover thy nakedness unto them, and they may see all thy nakedness.
So now I'm going to pull the covers off of you. I'm going to scatter you among all them nations, and they're going to look at you and just shake their head. Y'all had it. What happened? It's like we ain't had it. We've lost it for so long that people don't even know that we really had it. Mm. We even forgot we had it. That's why when we move in, people move out, and they don't even know why.
Make it plain.
If you just stay, the neighborhood may, you know, stay the same. But people want to run. When we come in, they want to get away from it. Whenever there's Israel involved in anything, it's a problem. And that's what we've been accustomed to because the stuff we see on TV. Mm. If you look at the stuff on TV in the 70s and all that, we only had what? We was only crooks and pimps.
Pretty much, that's it.
On TV, that's all they saw. And that's what, when people see that, that's what they think you are.
Right. Make it plain, brother.
I was watching the news the other day, and we got metal detectors in elementary schools. Elementary schools. These kids are what?
Kids.
Kids. Yeah. And you need a metal detector? But anyway, go ahead.
38. And I will judge thee as a woman that break wedlock and shed blood a judge, and I will give thee blood and fury and jealousy. And I will also give thee into their hand, and they shall throw down thine eminent place and shall break down thy high places. They shall strip thee also of thy clothes and shall take thy fair jewels and leave thee naked and bare.
So all that stuff I gave you, they're going to take it from you. And I gave it to you. I'm going to let them take it. Go to Jeremiah real quick. Jeremiah 18. So this is what we've come to. We're still a peculiar people. But now, it's in an unrighteous way.
Preach. Terrible.
It seemed like it take the Gentile to discover some of our foolishness before they put it out there like, you know, they found it. You know, like, what is this dancing? This Miley girl, whatever she did. Israel been doing that foolishness for the longest.
Since the slave ships.
I mean, come on. But the Gentile found our wickedness. We are peculiar people. It's like we were the only ones out there doing that. Now the Gentile found it. Now, okay, it's a good thing now. Everybody doing it.
Right. Right.
But it's wicked. Yeah. Israel did it. The peculiar people. They the ones that started this foolishness. Now we being mimicked in an unrighteous way. We teaching the world all kind of foolishness. When we should be teaching them righteousness. Where we at? Jeremiah what?
18.
Okay, 18 and 11. Read it.
Now therefore, go to, speak to the men of Judah and to the inhabitants of Jerusalem, saying, thus saith the Lord, behold, I frame evil against you and devise a device against you. Return ye now, everyone, from his evil way.
So he's giving you a shot now. Return everyone from your evil way. Go ahead.
And make your ways and your doings good. And they said, there is no hope. But we will walk after our own devices, and we will everyone do the imagination of his evil heart.
Forget that. We're going to do what we want to do. That's Israel. They don't want to be told what to do. Forget that, Jeremiah. We're going to do what we're going to do. Go ahead.
Therefore, thus saith the Lord, ask ye now among the heathen who have heard such things. The virgin of Israel have done a very horrible thing. Will a man leave the snow of Lebanon, which cometh from the rock of the field? Or shall the cold flowing waters that come from another place be forsaken? Because my people hath forgotten me. They have burned incense to vanity, and they have caused them to stumble in their own ways from the ancient paths, to walk in paths in a way not cast up, to make their land desolate, and a perpetual hissing. Everyone that passeth by shall be astonished and wag his head. I will scatter them as with an east wind before the enemy. I will show them the back and not the face in the day of their calamity.
So the Lord is fed up now. He's done. People going to walk by. It's like, you know, they look at us. They're like, man, what is wrong with them people? What is wrong with them? Let's go to Deuteronomy 28. Deuteronomy 28. And let's look at the flip side of that righteous peculiarity.
Yeah.
Because we stood out for righteousness for one hot minute. Now let's look at us. Deuteronomy 28, because we read the blessings in the beginning. Now let's look at, we ain't going to read all of these. This is a lesson within itself. We're just going to hit and miss a little bit. Deuteronomy 28, 15, read it.
But it shall come to pass, if thou wilt not hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God to observe to do all his commandments and his statutes, which I command thee this day, that all these curses shall come upon thee and overtake thee.
So it's the opposite of it, right?
Yeah.
Opposite of blessing is cursing. If you do right, you get blessed. You do wrong, you get cursed. Let's look at a few of the curses. Skip down to verse 20 and read it.
The Lord shall send upon thee cursing, vexation, and rebuke in all that thou settest thine hand unto for to do until thou be destroyed and until thou perish quickly because of the wickedness of thy doings whereby thou hast forsaken me.
Before you was prospering, now anything you touch, it don't turn to gold no more.
Turns to mush.
Everything you put forth your hand to do fails. You can't work enough overtime to get ahead. Your take-home pay can't even take you home.
Man.
Jeez. Skip down to verse 32 and read it.
Thy sons and thy daughters shall be given unto another people, and thine eyes shall look and fail with longing for them all the day long, and there shall be no might in thine hand.
Before you was conquering everybody else's people, now your sons and daughters are going to be given away. Like cattle, like pets.
Yow.
Animals are worth more than your life. Look at the news. This dude's house burned up. Only thing he was worried about was his dog. Is my dog okay? I made it out alive. I want to go, where's my dog at? What about the neighbors next door?
Huh.
But go ahead.
the fruit of thy land and all thy labors shall a nation which thou knowest not eat up, and thou shalt be only oppressed and crushed alway.
So that's another peculiarity amongst our people. Oppression. We are oppressed always.
Preach.
We are on the bottom of everything. Go ahead.
So that thou shalt be mad for the sight of thine eyes, which thou shalt see.
And we walk around mad all the time, mad at everybody. Man. Over there at Leimert Park, look at the mad Hebrews over there.
Man.
Just mad, mad at the world. And don't know why.
Huh.
Go ahead.
The Lord shall smite thee in the knees and in the legs with a sore botch that cannot be healed, from the sole of thy foot unto the top of thy head. The Lord shall bring thee and thy king, which thou shalt set over thee, unto a nation which neither thou nor thy fathers have known, and there shalt thou serve other gods, wood and stone.
We read that in Ezekiel. You want to serve these gods? Okay, I'm going to scatter you to all them nations, and you can serve them. And we serving them. Over here in America, where we the 50 million religions out here in America? Israel's in all of them. Krishna, Jehovah's Witness, Catholicism.
Mormons.
They didn't even want you in there.
Man.
And now you up in there. What else?
37.
Go ahead. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
And thou shalt become an astonishment, a proverb, and a byword among all nations, whether the Lord shall lead thee.
And that's another peculiarity amongst these people. We are a proverb and a byword amongst every nation. Everybody knows you. I don't care what nation you in. Everybody knows what the N-word is. My father told me when he was in Korea. They called him that too.
Wow.
Couldn't understand nothing else, but he knew what they was when they called him that.
Wow. Dang.
The byword. I mean, it's a bunch of them. Not just here. Everywhere you go. They got a hood in Canada that the Haitians live. They Israel. Neighborhoods just run down just like it is over here in America.
Dang.
And I'm quite sure they Canadians got a nice little word for them too. Because that word is universal.
The only word that is too.
45, read it.
Moreover, all these curses shall come upon thee and shall pursue thee and overtake thee till thou beest destroyed, because thou hearkenest not unto the voice of the Lord thy God to keep his commandments and his statutes which he commanded thee. And they shall be upon thee for a sign and for a wonder and upon thy seed forever.
So now before, our wisdom was supposed to be what in the sight of the nations? The commandments, keeping the law. Now, all these curses are on us in the sight of all the nations. And we're the only ones that got it. We are the only ones.
Preach, brother.
None of these curses fit any other nation but Israel.
That's real.
That's why we are a peculiar people in an unrighteous sense right now.
Make it plain.
We had it for a minute, but now it's gone. We're going to live this out until the Lord come back. 46, read it. 61. Go down to 61 and read that.
Also, every sickness and every plague which is not written in the book of this law, them will the Lord bring upon thee, until thou be destroyed. And ye shall be left few in number, whereas ye were as the stars of heaven for multitude, because thou wouldest not obey the voice of the Lord thy God.
So every sickness and every plague that's not written in this book, we going to have number one in everything. Diabetes, heart disease, cancer, AIDS. Go look at the Center for Disease Control?
CDC.
Look it up. It'll tell you by race who got everything.
It's true.
And at the top of the list is Israel. And people are like, wow. Well, that's a strange people.
Huh.
Strange, peculiar. Go ahead.
63. And it shall come to pass that as the Lord rejoiced over you to do you good and to multiply you, so the Lord will rejoice over you to destroy you and to bring you to naught, and you shall be plucked from the land whether thou goest to possess.
We read that in Ezekiel. He took us from nothing, brought us up to our own renown, so everybody knew about us for righteousness. And when we started getting big-headed, serving those other gods, he said, okay, I'm going to strip you naked just like I found you. And everybody going to laugh at you now. Huh. We finished that?
64.
Read it.
And the Lord shall scatter thee among all people from the one end of the earth even unto the other. And there thou shalt serve other gods which neither thou nor thy fathers have known, even wood and stone.
Read 65. It ain't in the lesson, but read that too. Let me throw that in there.
And among these nations shalt thou find no ease.
And among these nations you scattered, you get no rest. No rest at all. We have to work twice as hard to make the same amount of money. Keep reading.
Neither shall the sole of thy foot have rest, but the Lord shall give thee there a trembling heart and failing of eyes and sorrow of mind.
Isaiah 42. So this is the flip side of being a strange people. Now you're strange in wickedness. And you stand out. We stand out on everything. Isaiah 42, and start at verse 17. Read it.
They shall be turned back. They shall be greatly ashamed that trust in graven images, that say to molten images, ye are our gods. Hear ye deaf, and look ye blind, that you may see. Who is blind but my servant, or deaf as my messengers that I sent? Who is blind as he that is perfect and blind as the Lord's servant? Seeing many things, but thou observest not, opening the ears, but he heareth not.
You see, but you don't see. You hear, but you ain't listening.
Right.
Keep reading.
The Lord is well pleased for his righteousness' sake. He will magnify the law and make it honorable. But this is a people robbed and spoiled. They are all of them snared in holes, and they are hid in prison houses. They are for a prey and none delivereth, for a spoil and none saith restore.
So that's another characteristic of this peculiar people. Minority in the population, but the majority locked up.
Seriously.
That's strange. This people are strange. These are a nation of criminals.
Wow.
That's strange. But these are the Lord's people.
That's heavy.
Locked up. Majority locked up. Minority in the regular population. Keep reading.
23. Who among you will give ear to this? Who will hearken and hear for the time to come? Who gave Jacob for a spoil and Israel to the robbers? Did not the Lord? He against whom we have sinned.
That's why this could not be perpetrated by man.
Right.
This is the Lord doing this. This is identifying who his people are.
Yes.
He's doing this. He gave Jacob for a spoil and Israel to the robbers. Did not the Lord? He against whom we've sinned. Go ahead.
For they would not walk in his ways.
We did not want to walk in his way. What else?
Neither were they obedient unto his law.
And did not want to keep his law. And that was the blessings is all predicated on this.
Preach.
So if you don't want to do this, the Lord ain't got no choice but to curse you. He's even-handed.
Yes.
He gives you the choice. You make it. Apparently you don't want to do right. You want to do wrong. Okay. I will magnify you in the sight of everybody with your evilness. Mm. And all they're going to do is look at you and shake their head. Go ahead.
25. Therefore, he hath poured upon him the fury of his anger and the strength of battle. And it have set him on fire round about, yet he knew not. And it burned him, yet he laid it not to heart.
So all this stuff is happening, and you ain't even considering why. Why is this always happening to us?
Right.
Everybody else get a pass, but we can't get no pass with nothing. See people going in and out of that carpool lane all the time.
Man.
Dude. Let Israel do it once. Boom, there go the lights. I'm like, man.
$800 later, too. Man.
We can't get away with nothing because the Lord has got his eye on his people, and he's going to make sure you suffer for everything that you did and that you're doing right now. Go to, I'm going to throw this in, Isaiah 51. Flip right over to Isaiah 51. We're going to start wrapping it up. Isaiah 51, verse 17, start there.
Awake, awake, stand up, O Jerusalem, which has drunk at the hand of the Lord the cup of his fury. Thou hast drunken the dregs of the cup of trembling and wrung them out. There is none to guide her among all the sons whom she hath brought forth, neither is there any that has taken her by the hand of all the sons that she hath brought up.
And this is, nobody can guide you. You ain't getting it from your Sunday preacher.
Preach.
He want that money. They got one of them with the last name is money.
Yeah. Huh?
He don't care about you. He care about that dollar.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
These two things are come up unto thee. Who shall be sorry for thee? Desolation and destruction and famine and the sword. By whom shall I comfort thee? Thy sons have fainted. They lie at the head of all the streets. As a wild bull in a net, they are full of the fury of the Lord, the rebuke of thy God.
So what's at the head of the streets? The corners. Who's always hanging around on the corners?
Brothers.
Israel. These are, and that's strange.
Very peculiar.
Why? What's on the corner? Nothing. Other than the liquor store?
Nothing.
But why you want to hang around on the corner? But that's Israel. That's a strange people, peculiar. Let's go to
Hosea.
What?
Hosea.
Hosea, yeah, I didn't put that down. It's down here, though, ain't it?
He isn't.
I must have missed it.
Four.
Hosea 4. Let's go to Hosea 4. Hosea chapter 4. And we're going to pick it up at verse 1. Hosea 4, verse 1, read it.
Hear the word of the Lord, ye children of Israel. For the Lord hath a controversy with the inhabitants of the land, because there is no truth, nor mercy, nor knowledge of God in the land.
So ain't nobody keeping the law. So the Lord got a problem with it. What are he going to do? Go ahead.
By swearing and lying and killing and stealing and committing adultery, they break out, and blood toucheth blood. Therefore shall the land mourn. And everyone that dwelleth therein shall languish with the beasts of the field and with the fowls of heaven. Yea, the fishes of the sea also shall be taken away. Yet let no man strive nor reprove another, for thy people are as they that strive with the priest. Therefore shall they fall in the day, and the prophet also shall fall with thee in the night, and I will destroy thy mother.
So the Lord ain't playing. He got a problem with you if you ain't keeping the law. Go ahead.
My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge.
My people destroyed for lack of knowledge. As much as we stress, get that education, you still destroyed.
Huh. Make it plain.
Because you are destroyed for lack of knowledge, not this worldly knowledge, knowledge of the true and living God. That's why you messed up.
Preach, brother.
You can have a master's and walk down the street and police still don't care about you.
Preach, brother. Preach.
They don't care. Get some knowledge of the Lord. Go ahead.
Because thou hast rejected knowledge, I will also reject thee, that thou shalt be no priest to me. Seeing thou hast forgotten the law of thy God, I will also forget thy children.
Don't nobody care about the kids. They don't care about us. We animals. We kill each other up anyway. That's what they think about us.
It's true.
It's our kids out there dying in the streets. Why? Sunday preacher ain't doing his job. Every time they decide to pick and choose a case that they want to publicize on the media,
break it down, brother.
You see all these community faith leaders there at the news conference. Ain't saying nothing. We need, this is what we need, gun control and da-da-da-da-da, whatever their solution is, when all they got to do is read this book.
Preach, brother.
Read it and do it. But it's all media hype, you know. We are a people who, how can I put it? Something happens to us, we are merchandise. We merchandise, that's all it is.
Period.
This cat that got killed in Ferguson. Big media hype over there. You got all the big time, what is this, Al Sharpton. He a reverend, he ain't got no church. I ain't never heard of that. Where is your church, man? You on TV more than anything else.
Huh.
But you a reverend. Out for the money. Go ahead, keep reading.
7. As they were increased, so they sinned against me. Therefore will I change their glory into shame.
And that's that flip side of peculiarity. You're going to change your glory, what you had, into shame. And that's what we got. We on Shame Street.
Man.
Keep reading.
They eat up the sin of my people, and they set their heart on their iniquity. And there shall be like people, like priests, and I will punish them for their ways and reward them for their doings. For they shall eat and not have enough. They shall commit whoredom and shall not increase, because they have left off to take heed of to the Lord. Whoredom and wine and new wine take away the heart. My people ask counsel at their stocks, and their staff declareth unto them. For the spirit of whoredoms hath caused them to err, and they have gone a whoring from under their God.
Okay, go to Romans 11. We almost done. Romans 11. This is where we at right now. Peculiar people. On the flip side.
On the flip side.
Some of this stuff that's going on, we should be speaking out against, but we caught up in it. Poster child for sodomy. Ain't never seen. Go down Crenshaw, they got them billboards. You know? What is that? Why is it in our neighborhood?
Huh.
Romans 11, verse 1, read it.
I say then, hath God cast away his people? God forbid. For I also am an Israelite, of the seed of Abraham, of the tribe of Benjamin. God hath not cast away his people which he foreknew. Wot ye not what the scripture saith of Elias, how he maketh intercession to God against Israel, saying, Lord, they have killed thy prophets and dig down thine altars, and I am left alone, and they seek my life. But what saith the answer of God unto him? I have reserved to myself 7,000 men who have not bowed the knee to the image of Baal.
So God ain't cast away his people. Cast away meaning utterly destroyed. He just got them out of his sight because he's sick of them. But they still around because we here. But go ahead.
Even so then, at this present time also, there is a remnant according to the election of grace.
So there's a small few of us that's out here that know what's going on, that got our eyes open. Skip down to verse 7 and read.
What then? Israel have not obtained that which he seeketh for, but the election have obtained it, and the rest were blinded.
So some of us got our eyes open, but a majority of us don't. Go ahead.
According as it is written, God have given them the spirit of slumber, eyes that they should not see, and ears that they should not hear unto this day. And David saith, let their table be made a snare and a trap and a stumbling block and a recompense unto them. Let their eyes be darkened that they may not see, and bow down their back always.
So the Lord will shut your eyes. You know, that's why if you ever try to bring this truth to somebody,
make it plain,
and they just can't see it. The Lord has shut your eyes. Why? Because the X is on your back, and it's just a matter of time before he take you out. And when he wake you up, you're going straight to the lake of fire.
Man.
People don't believe this. This is the God that we serve. He will shut your eyes so you can be damned. We can read that.
Yeah, we can.
If you don't want to obey the truth, the Lord will shut your eyes. He will even turn you over to a reprobate mind.
That's what it says.
Keep reading.
11. I say then, have they stumbled that they should fall? God forbid, but rather through their fall, salvation is come unto the Gentiles for to provoke them to jealousy.
So because we fell off the map, salvation's come to the Gentiles. And now we mad at that. Israel find out they Israel, all of a sudden, they want to throw everybody under the bus.
Man.
Starting with the Gentiles first. But because we fell, salvation, because God is a God of all people.
Yes, sir.
Just because we done fell off the map, that don't mean we off the map. We still here. Everybody got a shot at this salvation.
Common.
If we'd have been on point, we wouldn't have this problem. But now everybody coming to us for the wrong reasons. We are being mimicked for the wrong reasons now. Everybody ain't laying out in the sun to get dark. Because you look like that. That's the wrong reason to be trying to be like Israel.
Right, no doubt.
Keep reading.
12. Now, if the fall of them be the riches of the world, and the diminishing of them the riches of the Gentiles, how much more their fullness? For I speak to you Gentiles, insomuch as I am the apostle of the Gentile, I magnify mine office. If by any means I may provoke to emulation them which are my flesh, and might save some of them.
Go ahead.
For if the casting away of them be the reconciling of the world, what shall the receiving of them be but life from the dead?
Go ahead.
For if the first fruit be holy, the lump is also holy, and if the root be holy, so are the branches. And if some of the branches be broken off, and thou, being a wild olive tree, were grafted in among them, and with them partakers of the root and the fatness of the olive tree, boast not against the branches. But if thou boast, thou bearest not the root, but the root thee. Thou wilt say then, the branches which were broken off, that I might be grafted in. Well, because of unbelief, they were broken off, and thou standest by faith. Be not high-minded, but fear.
So the Lord did something to Israel because of their disbelief, their disobedience. He scattered them. He said, you want to serve these false gods? Go ahead. I'm going to scatter you in every country, and you can do it. But because we got scattered, now somebody else going to pick up the ball and run with it. And remember, we read in the beginning, the oracles was only given to Israel.
Preach.
That's why this world is messed up now. You got this dude over here in Rome thinking he running the whole world under Christianity.
Man.
And he telling his people they can't even get married.
Man.
Where is that in the book? We can read in the book a priest had a wife.
Yes, sir.
So we see if you don't have it, if you don't have the answers, then you go about establishing your own righteousness.
Your imagination.
That's why you got so many different denominations out there.
Preach.
Everybody think they got it. Baptists think they got it. Methodists think they got it. Jehovah's Witnesses think they got it. Mormons think they got it. Lutheran, Episcopalian, the list goes on and on and on. Everybody think they got it. But I got some bad news for you. You ain't got it. It wasn't given to you. We finished that?
21.
Go ahead.
For if God spared not the natural branches, take heed, lest he also spare not thee.
Skip down to 25 and read it.
For I would not, brethren, that ye should be ignorant of this mystery, lest ye should be wise in your own conceits, that blindness in part has happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles come in.
So Israel is blinded in part. So if they blind, if some are blinded in part, that means the rest of them see.
Preach, brother.
Go ahead. 26, read it.
And so all Israel shall be saved, as it is written, there shall come out of Zion the deliverer, and shall turn away ungodliness from Jacob.
So how much Israel is going to be saved? All Israel.
Be brought back.
We coming back. Let's go to Deuteronomy 30. Jeremiah 30.
We coming back.
Jeremiah 30.
We coming back.
Pick it up at verse 1 and 2. Read it.
the word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord, saying, Thus speaketh the Lord God of Israel, saying, Write thee all the words that I have spoken unto thee in a book.
Go ahead, verse 3.
For lo, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will bring again the captivity of my people Israel and Judah, saith the Lord, and I will cause them to return to the land that I gave to their fathers, and they shall possess it.
So the day's gonna come, saith the Lord, that I will bring again the captivity of my people Israel and Judah, saith the Lord, and I will cause them to return to the land that I gave unto their fathers, and they shall possess it. We ain't over there yet.
Nah.
Whoever's over there thinking he's who this book, he ain't in this book.
Preach.
But I'm going to show you what's going to happen. Deuteronomy 30.
Yeah, make it plain.
Deuteronomy 30. Let's read it.
Why he ain't the one.
Deuteronomy 30.
That's right.
Because the Jew is not home. He's not in the land. He's still scattered, being a peculiar people in all these nations. Deuteronomy 30. And pick it up at verse 1. Deuteronomy 30 and verse 1. Read it.
And it shall come to pass, when all these things are come upon thee, the blessing and the curse.
So now, it's going to come to pass when all these things, the blessing, we had the blessing for a hot minute, now we're under the curse. And we got to live out every ounce of this curse. And once we're done living it out, the Lord is going to come back and get us. Go ahead.
Which I have set before thee, and thou shalt call them to mind among all the nations, whether the Lord thy God have driven thee, and shall return unto the Lord thy God, and shall obey his voice according to all that I command thee this day, thou and thy children, with all thine heart and with all thy soul, that then the Lord thy God will turn thy captivity and have compassion upon thee, and will return and gather thee from all the nations, whether the Lord thy God have scattered thee.
So he's going to come back himself.
That's right.
And gather Israel from all the nations where he scattered you. He's coming to get his people. Go ahead.
For if any of thine be driven out unto the utmost parts of heaven, from thence will the Lord thy God gather thee, and from thence will he fetch thee.
So if you're walking around in the jungle with a bone through your nose, can't even read and write, if you Israel, the Lord know it, and he gonna come and get you. Go ahead.
And the Lord thy God will bring thee into the land which thy fathers possessed, and thou shalt possess it. And he will do thee good and multiply thee above thy fathers. And the Lord thy God will circumcise thine heart and the heart of thy seed to love the Lord thy God with all thine heart and with all thy soul, that thou mayest live.
So he's going to circumcise your heart or your mind. He's going to wash that mind out again.
Again.
You're going to get brainwashed so you can learn to love the Lord, your God, with all your heart, with all your soul. Why? So you can live. Go ahead.
And the Lord thy God will put all these curses upon thine enemies and on them that hate thee, which persecuted thee.
So before all those other curses, for what? A sign and a wonder?
Yep.
For you? And when the Lord come back, he going to put them on everybody else.
That hated thee.
Because now you're going to be back on top like you're supposed to be in the beginning. Go ahead.
And thou shalt return and obey the voice of the Lord and do all his commandments, which I command thee this day.
Go ahead.
And the Lord thy God will make thee plenteous in every work of thy hand, in the fruit of thy body, in the fruit of thy cattle, in the fruit of thy land for good. For the Lord will again rejoice over thee for good, as he rejoiced over thy fathers.
So he's going to rejoice over you again.
Again.
Remember, he did it in the beginning. You messed up. Put you under the curse. Now he's going to come back and rejoice over you again. Go ahead.
If thou shalt hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God to keep his commandments and his statutes, which are written in this book of the law, and if thou turn unto the Lord thy God with all thine heart and with all thy soul.
There's that if again. Everything is predicated on if you keep these commandments.
If.
Go to Deuteronomy 14. We almost done. Deuteronomy 14. Pick it up at verse 1. 1 and 2 and 3. Read that. 14 and 1. Go ahead.
Ye are the children of the Lord your God. Ye shall not cut yourselves, nor make any baldness between your eyes for the dead.
So don't be cutting yourself. And we got other scriptures say you ain't supposed to put tattoos on your body. But what is Israel now? Tattoos everywhere. Skulls and all kind of foolishness. We the poster child. We are being mimicked for the wrong reasons now. We supposed to be, the nation of Israel supposed to be the true role models in righteousness.
Seriously.
But now we not. We in unrighteousness. Keep reading.
For thou art an holy people unto the Lord thy God, and the Lord have chosen thee to be a peculiar people unto himself above all the nations that are upon the earth.
Verse 3, what else? Go ahead.
Thou shalt not eat any abominable thing.
And that would make you stand out too. The dietary law. Stop eating that swine, shrimp, catfish,
preach,
oysters. Man. You start standing out.
Preach, brother.
People look at you like you're crazy. First of all, they think you Islam.
Yeah.
Because you don't eat pork, they think you Islam. No, it's in the Bible, don't eat it.
Right.
I don't care how long you grew up on it. Once you stop eating it, you stop eating it.
Preach.
Let's go to Titus 2. I got three more places. Titus 2. So people that eat everything, they don't stand out. They're going along with the world.
Yep.
Stop eating certain things. You stand out.
Real talk.
You strange. You peculiar. Queer, a weirdo, whatever they call it. There's a lot of synonyms for it. I didn't read them all.
You a weirdo.
You a square.
Yeah.
That's back in the 70s, wasn't it? A square?
Yeah, square.
They still say that?
L7. L7 at the game. That's the Old Testament.
Titus 2. Pick it up at verse 11. Titus 2 and verse 11. Okay, read.
For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men, teaching us that, denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world.
That's right. That's how we're supposed to live. That's what makes you stand out. Go ahead.
Looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity, and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works.
That's right. Hosea 1. Hosea chapter 1.
That's a very good one.
A peculiar people, zealous of good works.
Yeah.
Not unrighteous works, but good works.
Zealous of good works.
Don't weary yourself in doing good. I'm just paraphrasing, but y'all know what I'm talking about. Don't get tired of doing good.
Due season.
Hosea chapter 1. We're going to read verse 10 and 11. Hosea 1, 10. Okay, verse 10, read it.
Yet the number of the children of Israel shall be as the sand of the sea, which cannot be measured nor numbered. And it shall come to pass that in the place where it was said unto them, ye are not my people, there it shall be said unto them, ye are the sons of the living God.
So the same place that the Lord said, I'm through with y'all, I'm kicking you out. The same place is going to be when he say, look, you are the children of the living God. Go ahead, verse 11.
Then shall the children of Judah and the children of Israel be gathered together and appoint themselves one head. And they shall come up out of the land, for great shall be the day of Jezreel.
Okay, Psalm 148. Psalm 148. And we're going to pick it up at verse 13. Okay, read.
Let them praise the name of the Lord, for his name alone is excellent. His glory is above the heaven and earth. He also exalted the horn of his people, the praise of all his saints, even the children of Israel, a people near unto him.
Israel,
praise ye the Lord.
A people near unto him, the people he chose to give the lively oracles to. We got the answers. Don't nothing change. Psalm 135, last verse. Psalm 135. One verse. Verse 4. Okay, read it.
For the Lord hath chosen Jacob unto himself and Israel for his peculiar treasure.
And I hope you got some understanding in Jesus' name.